The theme, national governance in a global society, has a simple designation, but in fact it's quite complicated. Today, national governance is largely a matter of national constitutional sovereignty. For the last 300 years, the issue of sovereignty has been controversial, both globally and domestically. In the global sphere, one of the problems with sovereignty is the implicit understanding that sovereignty is an absolute matter. It's a matter of state absolutism. And therefore, in most societies where there's at least some degree of democratic participation, there will always be some resistance to the notion that constitutional sovereignty is not ideologically contested. Not everyone likes the idea of sovereign absolutism. Regardless, one of our great problems of the last 700 years has been how we can domestically and internationally constrain sovereign absolutism. In the 20th century, sovereign absolutism resulted in total war and unprecedented violations of human rights. And the disaster occasioned the creation of war aims by the Allies, Churchill and Roosevelt, and the Congress of the United States, enacted the Atlantic Charter and its four freedoms: freedom of speech and expression, freedom of conscience and belief, freedom from fear, and freedom from want. These principles actually became the cornerstone of the global constitutional system after the Second World War. And the UN Charter today is based on these four principles. Now, the composition of the international community comprises of sovereign states mainly, but the central point is that most of these states came into existence after the UN Charter had been adopted. And almost every one of these states had to have a constitution that would be consistent with the UN Charter, because they would not be given membership in the UN unless their constitutions fell in line with the fundamental values for freedom, basically, of the UN Charter.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. So most of the constitutions today are not quite a product of the internal fight for power. It's partly international and partly the influence of the values of the four freedoms. So everyone, either implicitly or explicitly, has assumed into its constitutional system the four freedoms, you see. Now, they may not agree with them, but they had to if they wanted to be members of the UN and so forth.
They did it.
Yeah, they had to do it. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. Okay, so then the question becomes, now what does this kind of constitution have to do with the question of the national identity of the participators? Since it's partly fueled by a form of international progressivism, and partly their own fight for self-determination and independence. Not an easy matter to reconcile, because the people who fight for self-determination and independence proclaim the virtues of the UN Charter, but when they get their independence, they want sovereign absolutism, just like their colonial masters. So it's a real problem, and that itself is a factor that breeds conflict about what the fundamental identities are of the constituent members of the UN. Okay? Now, the central problem of the UN Charter is that it is a form of constitutionalism, but a rather unusual form. We never had this until we had the UN Charter. We had an approximation to something like this with the League of Nations. But as you all know, the League of Nations succumbed to the absolutist sovereignty principle. When the Japanese invaded China, they vetoed and blocked the UN in its tracks. When the Italians invaded Abyssinia, ditto. And essentially the League became nothing, because it could not act juridically to constrain its sovereign members. Sovereign absolutism remained omnipotent. Now, the what we then have today is we have a global constitutional system that has many weaknesses. I just mentioned two, but there are many others. One is the power to maintain international peace and security, which is vested in the Security Council. The mutation of sovereign absolutism is that five permanent members of the Security Council can veto anything and block the UN's peace process in its tracks.
Super sovereignty.
Super duper sovereignty. So there'd be talk about modest reform, but the Bush administration, the last time we had something, vetoed it because they didn't want to have the veto compromised. Although many people felt if you put two or three more states in and add the permanent members, one or two more votes, you could probably moderate the worst effects of it. But nonetheless, this weakness is there, and that's the way it is right now. The second weakness is the role of the General Assembly. All the constituent members are members of the General Assembly, but overwhelmingly, the General Assembly makes resolutions, and these resolutions are non-binding. They have no legal effect whatsoever. So there's a ton of General Assembly resolutions, but there's virtually no enforcement mechanism because the states are not bound by it. Although lawyers, we argue, for example, that if a state in good faith votes the goddamn thing, why should it act inconsistent with the way it publicly voted? That's stupid. But there's nothing you can do about it. They say, yeah, we vote, but we're not bound by it. Okay? There's only one area which is undeveloped from the General Assembly, and that is when the Security Council blocked the UN, the US and others proposed something to the General Assembly called the Uniting for Peace Resolution. And this meant that if the General Assembly can enact a resolution with an overwhelming majority, it can override the Security Council. They only did it once. After that, the US wouldn't back it because all these third world countries were coming in and they wouldn't have a veto anymore. And the Russians, of course, love the veto. So between the two superpowers, the hell with this idea of uniting for peace. It's never been taken off the books. It's still there, but neither superpower wants to hear a word about the uniting for peace resolution that once was. So those are the two main limitations. Now, getting back to the problem of state sovereignty. The fundamental problem at the global level is how do you reconcile the principle of state sovereign absolutism with the principle of international juridical concern? In short, when matters are matters that affect all of us, those are matters of international concern, and there should be some constitutional mechanism by which the global system can respond. Bottom veto and all that's, but this tension remains consistently there, and it comes out very explicitly in the context of where the states who voted for all the human rights stuff are bound by it, and China, Russia, and several others say we voted for it, but we're not bound by it. We would have to specifically adopt the specific provisions and say that they bind us before we are bound. So yeah, they all say we're for human rights, but they're not bound by it. So that's. Given the promise of the revolutionary principle of the elevation of human identity as a matter of international concern by human rights remains a matter of somewhat unfulfilled promise. That's the global picture. Now, the business of state sovereignty and state exclusivism, that's the one we need to deal with, and that forces us to begin to ask some basic questions. What is a constitution? How does a constitution impact upon human identity at the national level? And one of the contested problems here is we really don't have a very good idea as to what a constitution is. All you got to do is listen to this guy's Gavanna. How in the hell he got through law school, I don't know, but Yale must have been lowering its standards, so I can say. So there's a real, and most of those judges, incidentally, with all due respect, hardly any of them know legal theory. So they bumble along and instinctively go this way and that way, but it's one of the most unsophisticated institutions dispensing the highest level law without an adequate theoretical understanding of what exactly they're doing. That's it. Now, question that I put to you, and you can consider for a moment, you assume that you know what a constitution, what is a constitution? Anyone want to have a guess at it?
The rules of the nation, the basic guideline rules of the nation, or the guidelines for the rules.
You'd have a problem with it.
It's just
a technical problem. Mm-hmm. There's a way in which you define a rule, mm-hmm. But that's different to the way you define a principle. Mm-hmm. And that's different.
I was saying guidelines for rules.
Oh,
so it's no. Principles.
Then what you'd have to do is you can't look at the document. You've got to look at a library full of
guidelines
and decisions and so forth. I don't think any of the most sophisticated of our lawyers has ever read every goddamn thing there. So those guidelines are a little bit of a misnomer. They are guidelines, but that doesn't quite tell us what we mm-hmm. mean by a constitution. Well, there are three possible ways to look at it. One is, this is what Kavanaugh and all these right-wingers are saying, constitution is a piece of paper. That's it. Mm-hmm. Whatever is written there, but if you begin to unpack the goddamn thing, it's almost meaningless. Okay? But they say, oh, just read it and it will tell you. So, just take a simple example. They wrote this thing called the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms. What arms were they talking about? Bazookas? AK-47s? Technology as far outstripped the goddamn thing, and they're still talking about as if we're talking about
powder.
And I can go through a whole scale of things where technology has clearly gone ahead of these guys, and they all tell us, oh no, we only want to do what was written in 1790, whatever it was. This is stupid.
Then they should buy 1970.
Yeah, right.
1790s guns.
So your first one is this stupid idea that the establishment buys.
Exactly.
Sorry, okay. What's the second one? The second one is more interesting. This came from a very famous scholar, 1930s, Carl Llewellyn. I think it was German exception, I'm saying. But Carl Llewellyn said the Constitution is an institution. So it's not a piece of paper. The paper is some guidelines to something more important. It's a living, dynamic instrumentality in which human beings and lawyers and decision makers, we all interact to produce, hopefully, a sensible result consistent with some of our most basic and fundamental ideas about freedom, liberty, equality, and so on. That has been the durable idea amongst scholars, but the right wing hates it because it says there are circumstances when you put in modest change. You know, you at some point you say, look, slavery is a stupid thing, and let's give the people their rights. Women are human beings, they deserve the voting rights, and so on. So the Constitution as an institution is possibly a more descriptive statement of what we mean by the rules behind the Constitution. But because Llewellyn was a liberal and the academics were always viewed as far too red and pink to be taken seriously, there was a reaction to this. Now, I should just mention one other thing here. When Llewellyn was doing this, we were in the middle of the New Deal. And the New Deal was considered by the right wing to be some form of communism. And therefore, judges who were upholding the New Deal were traitors. And therefore, a theory that permitted a rational role of a social democratic government between the courts, the legislature, and the executive, that was considered to be, that was progressive constitutionalism. But it had its enemies, and its enemies were on the right. They never forgot. Because while they realized that institutions of the New Deal were popular, They knew they couldn't directly assault the New Deal. So they developed other strategies, indirect methods. The most frightening thing for those who were against the New Deal was, after the Second World War, this country experienced the most massive social revolution in human history. And that was the emergence of the huge and somewhat progressive American middle class. And it was a model that was exported to Europe and India and most of the world has followed some version of this relatively successful model of social democracy. Now this is, right up until today, there's a furious battle as to how the right wing and Trump and these guys can destroy the institutions of the New Deal, which have been the bane of the right wing Republicans, okay? The idea of the deep state, kill the American government, you kill the Constitution, and then of course you've left us with oligarchy. So that's been the discourse. Now, Yale produced some revolutionary thinkers, and Lloyd knows some, and I will talk to some of them. But the most revolutionary idea of what a constitution is came from my mentor and Lloyd's mentor, and was published, it was called The World Process of Constitutive Authority. Okay? And this was the most radically process-oriented idea of what the Constitution is, what its objectives are, what its methods are, what methods are to be used, and it worked on a very complex formulation that Laswell came up with, and that was the most important problem for law is not that general. It's how you take the generalized versions and the particularized problems and you manage them. It's taking our great and wonderful abstractions of liberty, equality, etc., and grounding them in instances of particular application. Because you're real life litigants, you've got real life nuances of issues. How do you do that? How can you technically do that with competence? That, of course, is still the great challenge, but it's denied by many people who say, oh, just logic and things like that. So, what I've done, what did I do with it? I sent Gary this, but apparently he didn't get it. I sent him, you'll find the pages there, I've got one page maps of the social process, the power process, and the constitutive process. Just one page, but it maps out how you think about it and how you work through problems using the map as a guide. So this is the most advanced view that I have seen. And when Gary put me in touch with some English scholars who are now wanting to do the UK Constitution, I sent them this article they freaked out at first. Then I wrote a number of follow-up memos, and most of the ideas that we gave them have been plugged into the document that they're going to use to propose a declaration for a new constitution of the UK. And your pal mentioned the Commons idea, and I had written an article on the Commons integrated into this as well, and they use the Commons idea as a way to change the focus of private property and meaningful popular participation in fairer, equitable economic procedures. Well, okay, but the maps that you can just, it's one page, it's not a PDF. Okay, so that's, and what they did, and to my knowledge no one else has done, American constitution law is parochial, is that it looks at the ways in which constitutions function horizontally and vertically, any other trajectories. And then we try to figure out the critical questions which come from the map. Who are the actors involved in the Constitution? Who's excluded? Who's included? The Constitution that excludes all the population is a problem, as you probably know. And so by posing the question about participation and then How does the Constitution manage human identity, sexuality, transgender, race, women, whatever? All of these become specific issues with vast clusters of sub-issues, all of which are specific and all of which require careful delineation and analysis. Now, that's what we call, if you like, constitutional interpretation. That's the heart of the matter. And if you ask me, where does the legitimacy of the system lie? It's not in the mere words on paper. It's the sophistication, the thoughtfulness, and the careful appraisal of all the multiple interests that go into the making of a constitutional decision as fundamental law.